Hi, I am Dr. Selvaraj, your surgical educator from Malaysia. Welcome back to my series of surgical teaching video casts. These are meant mainly for undergraduate medical students during their surgical clerkship rotation. I promise you will become competent in clinical problem solving and surgical decision making if you are going to watch these videos over and over again. So in this episode today, I am going to discuss one more cause for generalized abdominal pain, that is sigmoid volvulus. So in this presentation, I am going to discuss under the following subheadings. So after watching this presentation, all of you should be able to know that the different causes for the generalized abdominal pain, the epidemiology and the risk factors, pathology, clinical factors, differential diagnosis, investigations and treatment of sigmoid volvulus. Of course, I have included a mind map, a diagnostic algorithm, and a treatment algorithm as well. So these are the different causes for generalized abdominal pain. So they are small bowel obstruction, gastroenteritis, paralytic ileus, large bowel obstruction, including sigmoid volvulus, colonic pseudo obstruction or Ogilvie syndrome, and acute mesenteric ischemia. So these are the different causes for generalized abdominal pain. And in this column, you are seeing the characteristic history and physical or the clinical features for each of these causes. I request my viewers to pause the video and read all these particulars. So what is a volvulus? Volvulus occurs when a segment of colon undergoes twisting along its own mesentery, that is the mesenterioaxial axis, and that results in obstruction. Twisting of 180 degree results in clinical obstruction, and further twisting to 360 degree causes strangulation with venous gangrene, ischemia, and eventually perforation and peritonitis. Actually, it is a closed loop obstruction. This is an example for closed loop obstruction. This is common in elderly people and those who are taking neuropsychiatric drugs. Sigmoid volvulus accounts for 5% of large bowel obstruction in developed countries, whereas it is 10 to 15% in developing countries. This is because of high intake of high fiber diet in these developing countries. Patients are often already admitted in the hospital and they are debilitated due to either the underlying neurological problem or some psychiatric disease, and they have history of constipation as well. So coming to the risk factors, the higher incidence in developing countries is attributed to intake of high fiber diet, a large quantity of high fiber diet that causes this sigmoid volvulus. It is seen mostly in elderly people, that too in male it is very common, and already they have been hospitalized with chronic neuropsychiatric conditions. Usually these patients will have long pelvic mesocolon. See, long mesocolon. This is the pelvic mesocolon or sigmoid mesocolon. So this is very long or redundant. Narrow attachment of the pelvic mesocolon. See, even though it is broad here the base of this, mesocolon, the sigmoid mesocolon is very narrow. Yeah, that is what narrow attachment of pelvic mesocolon. Overloaded pelvic colon happens in constipation, and patients is also taking high fiber diet. So lot of fecal matter will get loaded in the sigmoid colon, and that is also a risk factor. And another important cause, a loop of bubble fixed at its apex by adhesion. This is what you are seeing here. This is the apex of this loop. So there is some adhesion to the apex of this loop of the bubble. So, and that is also a risk factor. So coming to the pathology, what happened? The bubble twists on its own mesenteric axis. So this causes bubble obstruction if it is 180 degrees. If it is more than that, say 360 degrees, venous congestion will take place and bubble will go for venous gangrene and bubble infarction, and finally that will perforate and that will produce peritonitis. So this is what you are seeing here. The loop of sigmoid colon usually undergoes twisting in an anti-clockwise direction from one half to three turns. It takes place not just one turn, three turns it can go in anti-clockwise direction. Not like this, it will go like this, anti-clockwise. Okay, as the valvuli segment enlarges, because of this obstruction, closed loop obstruction, this part of the bubble or this loop of the bubble will undergo enormous distension and it becomes trapped in the confines of abdominal wall and it is unable to spontaneously get detached. It cannot untwist on its own because it enlarges enormously and this will be trapped by the anterior abdominal wall. So coming to the clinical features, that is symptoms and signs. What are the symptoms? The patient will definitely, they'll have abdominal pain. Initially it is left lower quadrant pain. Eventually that becomes diffuse pain all over the abdomen. Then the very, very characteristic or pathognomonic finding is the enormous abdominal distension. Left iliac fossa and then whole of the abdomen will get distended. Patient will be having obstipation. That means patient is not only passing fecal matter, patient is also not passing even the flatus. That is what is called obstipation. Some of these patients may have hiccough because of the enormous dilatation and some may have retching also. Vomiting, if it happens, usually it is a very late feature, and because it is large bowel obstruction, the patient will have what is called feculent vomiting, and this is a late feature. Coming to the signs, if you percuss the abdomen, the patient will have tympanic abdomen. Tire-like consistency of the abdomen is very diagnostic. Enormous dilatation of the abdomen, that is tire-like. Empty, if you do a digital rectal exam, you can feel the empty rectal vault. If the abdomen is just distended without tenderness, usually this is because of the underlying bowel is still viable. If patient is having generalized tenderness with rebound tenderness also, okay, the bowel is already gangrenous. Apart from generalized tenderness and rebound tenderness, if patient is also having rigid abdomen, probably that gangrenous bowel has perforated already and patient has gone for peritonitis. So these are very important finding you have to elicit, or the signs. So these are the clinical intraoperative pictures. This is what it looks like. So after laparotomy, immediately after opening the abdomen, this will pop out. So this is distended like a tire. This is the loop of the sigmoid colon. Here this bubble is viable, whereas this bubble is already gangrenous. Here it is gray color, but here it is frank gangrene. You can see the block color sigmoid colon, already gangrenous. So either it is like this gray color or block color, you have to resect it. You cannot, keep it inside. You have to resect this part of the bowel. I will discuss this in the treatment in detail regarding how to manage these conditions. So you have to do blood tests, full blood count and serum electrolytes you have to do. You should also do renal function test, that is blood urea and creatinine. But the gold standard investigation in these patients is the abdominal x-ray erect, that is diagnostic. Okay, here you are seeing two pictures, both are showing the same findings. So this appearance, enormous dilatation of the sigmoid colon, that is having a characteristic appearance of coffee bean appearance. This looks like a coffee bean. You can see three linear lines. So here one line, here another line, here one more line. All these three lines will converge in the left iliac fossa, and this sign is called Freeman-Dall sign. And this coffee bean appearance is also known as bent inner tube sign and omega sign. So here also you are seeing the same thing. So this is the characteristic coffee bean appearance. So the other investigation, you can also do barium enema. Here you are seeing the barium enema, which will show the characteristic bird's beak appearance. This is what you are seeing, the bird's beak appearance, or the ace of spurred sign. Here you are seeing the ace of spurred sign. The upper end of the barium column tapers into the spirally twisted distal sigmoid colon. Here the sigmoid colon is twisted, so this barium is tapering there. This is the upper end of the barium column. So this is a barium enema, but nowadays we are not doing this test. There is no need to do the barium enema. So the in doubtful cases, okay, you can do CT abdomen. So in CT abdomen, you can see the characteristic whirl sign or whirlpool sign, which represent the tension on the tightly twisted mesocolon by the afferent and efferent limbs of the dilated colon. This is what you are seeing. This is the whirlpool sign. Here also you are seeing the same finding. This is very characteristic CT finding. This you can do it only for doubtful cases. You can do this CT abdomen. So coming to treatment, many of these patients will be already, they may be in shock. So you have to resuscitate them by giving IV fluids. You have to rush in 3 to 4 liters of IV fluids, and then you must start antibiotic, broad spectrum antibiotic also. Catheterize the bladder, and you have to measure the urine output also. This is what you have to do. You have to stabilize the patient first, and then after that, either you can go for conservative treatment or you can go for operative treatment straight away. That you have to decide whether the bowel is ischemic or not. So what is the indication for the conservative management? If the patients are young and without signs of ischemia, then you can go for conservative management. So what is this conservative management? You can do either rigid and flexible sigmoidoscopy, negotiate the obstruction, and decompress the proximal large bowel. So this, if you successfully, if you are able to decompress, then you have to put a rectal tube inside for 3 or 4 more days to decompress the proximal bowel adequately. But the chances of recurrence after a successful decompression is more than 50%. So in order to prevent this recurrence, you can do either percutaneous endoscopic sigmoidopexy. This is non-resectional surgery. Or you can do mesosigmoidoplasty. To prevent recurrence, either you can do percutaneous endoscopic sigmoidopexy or mesosigmoidoplasty. Both are non-resectional surgery because we are not resecting any segment of the bowel. Or if you are not very comfortable or confident, then you can do sigmoid colectomy. This is a resectional surgery, but this you can do as an elective procedure. Okay, because you have decompressed the proximal bowel, but you want to do surgery, means you can do it, but you can prepare the bowel, do sigmoid colectomy, and then immediately you can do primary anastomosis. Suppose if the patient is a old patient with signs of ischemia, then you should not try conservative management. You should do what is called exploratory laparotomy. After going in, if you find the bowel is viable, you can now either you can do a sigmoidopexy or sigmoidectomy. Okay, But if the bowel is viable, it is, even then it is better to do sigmoidectomy. If bowel is non-viable, there is no question of sigmoidopexy, you must do only resection. So after resection, you can do two types of colostomy. One is the Paul Mikulis double barrel colostomy. These two I will show you in the next slide. Paul Mikulis double barrel colostomy or the Hartmann's procedure. Either you can do the Paul Mikulis or Hartmann's procedure. But you should never do primary anastomosis in an emergency scenario for fear of anastomotic leakage. So you should do either the Paul Mikulis colostomy or Hartmann's procedure, but never do a primary anastomosis in an emergency scenario. So this is what is the Paul Mikulis double barrel colostomy. So this is the sigmoid valveless. You just exteriorize this loop of the bowel outside, then you can resect this thing, this colon, proximal and distal colon, and bring both the end together as a double barrel. So both are lying nearby. So this is what is called Paul Mikulis double barrel colostomy. Whereas in Hartmann's procedure, okay, this is Hartmann's procedure. This is the sigmoid colon. This, you have to resect this part of the sigmoid colon. The proximal colon, you can bring it out as temporary end colostomy. The distal part of the segment, colon or rectum, you can close it and keep it inside the peritoneal cavity. So here, the one end, the distal end is not outside, it is lying inside the peritoneal cavity. Whereas the proximal end of the colon, you have brought it out as temporary end colostomy. So this is Hartmann's procedure or Hartmann's temporary end colostomy. Sigmoid valveless, what are the risk factors? Long pelvic mesocolon, a narrow base of the pelvic mesocolon, high fiber diet, loaded sigmoid colon because of constipation, and band of adhesion at the peak of that bowel loop. And then the neuropsychiatric patients. Pathology, the bowel is twisted on its mesenteric axis. Bowel is obstruction is there and it is dilated also. Then it will go for venous gangrene, and then eventually the bowel will go for gangrene and then perforation and peritonitis. Coming to the clinical features, there is generalized abdominal pain, enormous abdominal distension. There will be obstipation. Patient may have hiccup and retching. Vomiting is a late feature. And tympanitic, if you examine the abdomen, you will have a tympanitic note. Usually, if you do a digital rectal examination, the rectal vault is empty. If it is viable bowel, okay, there will be only distension of the abdomen without any tenderness. If bowel is non-viable, apart from the distension, patient will be having generalized tenderness and rebound tenderness. So if it is perforated bowel, then apart from generalized tenderness and rebound tenderness, patient also will have rigidity. That is, the rigidity is the hallmark sign of perforated discus or the perforated peritonitis, perforative peritonitis. Coming to the investigation, the gold standard investigation is abdominal x-ray erect. That will show that a characteristic coffee bean appearance, or this is also known as bent inner tube sign, or the omega sign, or the Freemendall sign, all are same. Or you can do barium minima, that may show the bird's beak appearance or ace of spades sign, but nowadays we are not doing barium minima. In doubtful cases, you can go for CT abdomen, that will show the Whirlpool sign. Coming to the treatment, if patient is a young patient and there is no sign of ischemia, you can go for conservative treatment, where you can try to do either the rigid or flexible sigmoidoscopic decompression of the proximal bowel. So after that, the recurrence is more than 50%. In order to avoid this recurrence, you can do percutaneous endoscopic sigmoidopexy or mesosigmoidoplasty. Both are non-resectional procedure. Okay, if patient is an elderly patient and there are signs of ischemia, then you can go for sigmoid colectomy. And after doing this sigmoid colectomy, in case of emergency, you should not do primary anastomosis. You can do either the Paul Michaelis double barrel colostomy or the Hartmann's procedure, where you will be doing the proximal temporary end colostomy. So this is the diagnostic algorithm for generalized abdominal pain, not specific for sigmoid valvulus alone. So if it is generalized tenderness and if the patient's amylase is elevated, so if it is more than 4 times, then most probably we are dealing with a case of acute pancreatitis. Suppose if the amylase is normal, you have to do an erect chest x-ray. If we are seeing free gas and the diaphragm, okay, it is a case of perforated hollow viscous. Suppose if it is localized tenderness, that is, okay, that acute appendicitis, acute cholecystitis, acute pancreatitis, all will come under the localized tenderness. So colic pain, very little pain and no tenderness at all. If it is central abdomen, you have to take an abdominal x-ray, you can see the small bowel dilatation. Most probably, we are dealing with small bowel obstruction. If it is colic pain is mainly in the suprapubic area, you have to do an abdominal x-ray. Okay, it is a large bowel dilatation. If you can do even to confirm it, gastrograph in enema you can give. So we are dealing with a case of large bowel obstruction, not only sigmoid valvulus, any large bowel obstruction. Okay, this is also you can see. If the pain is flank pain, so then probably you have to do a KUB x-ray or IVU. Nowadays we are not doing IVU. Instead of IVU, now we are doing what is called CT urography or non-contrast single slice spiral CT. That is what we are doing for all ureteric colic cases now. That we are dealing either a renal colic or a ureteric colic. Treatment algorithm. So this is valvulus, not just sigmoid valvulus, any valvulus. So you have to take a thorough history and physical, this you know. Then diagnosis you have to confirm by doing just a plain x-ray. In doubtful cases, you can go for CT scan. Suppose if the valvulus is small bowel one, okay, you have to do surgical intervention. This I haven't discussed in this presentation. If it is cecal valvulus is very rare. This only surgery you have to do. You have to do a resection. If it is a sigmoid valvulus, okay, I told you, first you have to try the conservative management, that is the endoscopic decompression. You can try the colonoscopy, okay, if it fails, then surgical intervention only you can do. If it is already gangrenous and peritonitis, then you have to do only surgery. So you have to resect it, and then either you can go for primary anastomosis or you have to do only colostomy in majority of these cases. So thank you very much for watching this video. If you think that these videos are very useful, kindly subscribe to this channel and share these videos in your social media. Thank you once again for watching this video. Let us meet in another episode. Until then, bye-bye.